Welcome back, everybody. So I just wanted to make a follow-up video to the video I made earlier in regards to survival foods. A lot of back and forth. It's been really good, and I want to continue the conversation on in another video. And so before I start, I want people to realize when I look at preparedness, I look at it not from an emotional lens, because emotions gets people killed. I look at it from science, I look at it from math, I look about what is most efficient. And I feel like a lot of people forget that about me because, I know that people prepare a certain kind of way because we see these large YouTube conglomerates and they're always peddling the fear porn. They're always peddling the headlining of these are the top 10 food supplies you need to hoard now. These are the top 10 survival foods for shit hits the fan and all this other fucking bullshit. Now, I'm going to do a video later on in the very near future about why I believe that storing and hoarding more than a month's worth of survival foods really puts you at a disadvantage. And we'll talk about that in another video. But really, today, I want to talk about food pragmatically. Because if you're not looking at food sustainability, if you're not looking at food through a regenerative lens, you're doing it all wrong. And I'm very unapologetic about that fact. And the reason being is whether you decide to grow your own food, raise your own animals, or you decide that you're just going to purchase large amount of survival foods, at some point you're going to need to look and realize that there is needing to be a regeneration plan, whether that's you're going to go out and buy it, barter it, or you're going to go out and grow it, cultivate it. And so regardless of which one you do, you have to come to the realization that you're going to fucking need more of it. Okay. And I think that's what is most missed upon this in the overall conversation. I don't care if you buy it, I don't care if you barter it, I don't care if you grow it, I don't care if you cultivate it. Ultimately, though, you're going to fucking need more of it. Okay? And so that's why when we're looking at this through a preparedness lens, it's obvious the most important and I would say efficient way to go about that is through the lens of sustainability, through the lens of growing it yourself, harvesting yourself, or at least procuring it locally. Okay? And so when we understand this realization that you can't separate preparedness from sustainability, and pragmatically, you can't separate the acquisition of goods from the ability to either produce it or purchase it, when we look at that pragmatically and understand it, yes, that is the case. When I eat it, I need to replenish it with fucking something, right? So once we get over that lens of understanding, we realize that that is ultimately a fact and it's true. Well, what are we gonna do about it, right? And it comes to the now, this really comes to the foundation that I'm trying to build here, and that is, a lot of people tell me all the time, you don't understand unapologetic prepper. You have no idea. You are on lots of acreage. You can grow your own food. I can't. I don't have acreage, therefore I can't grow my own food. And I get that a lot. And face value, that may seem like, oh, that's understandable. For me, it's not. And the reason being is because even when I was living in the city, I was able to produce large amounts of food and I was able to make a big dent in my food supply plan by just using a standard yard. So what I'm going to do today is I'm just going to show you conceptual ideas just from being here on the homestead right now. So right now we're just going to do a quick walkthrough of my homestead and I'm going to show you how you can literally grow hundreds of pounds of food a month using a standard yard. I mean, we'll talk about it in a little bit, but just with rabbits alone, without very much work, 50 pounds of high quality meat each month. And then we're going to obviously talk about some of the roadblocks here at the very end. But ultimately, if you really care about sustainability, you really care about food preparedness, and being ready in your person, in your household, these are some really easy steps that you can do. So we're just going to do a quick walkthrough of my homestead. I'm going to show you some easy ways to grow lots of food in just a little bit of space. So stay with me. So here we have some tilapia. Now, I got these guys when they were tiny, like little fry, like you couldn't even see them. And they've been growing like weeds. So we've had them for about a month now. They're doing great. Obviously, COVID likes to watch them too. But you can see they're just in a big aquarium, simple aquarium that just sits right here on this little entertainment center thing. Basic gravel substrate and a biofilter right here. Nothing special. You can see the water's clean and they're just in there living their best lives. And all I've been feeding them is this top fin goldfish flakes. Again, this is super easy to do. I got this for literally pennies on the dollar. And so
We're just going to get them big enough until we can put them into their aquaponic system. So tilapia are a great way to produce food year-round, both as a meat source and high-quality plant source, whether that be your vegetables, leafy greens, tomatoes, what have you. So aquaponics is absolutely outstanding. Great way to produce a lot of food in a small space. So as you can see here, we have a lot of birds, and all our birds are free range. Now this is their coop. This is a pretty big coop, but do they need all that space? No. I have grown out, and you guys have seen those videos, I've grown out dozens of meat birds, both duck and chicken, in a small space like this. In fact, we'll go over here and I'll show you one of the great concepts that I really like when it comes to raising birds. Look at this cute girl right here. So right here we have grow out tractors. Now you guys have seen me show these in other videos, but these are great. Basically they're wood that I've stapled chicken wire to, and I have grown out birds, whether that's chickens, ducks, rabbits, I've grown them out in here. And what's great about it is you can take rope like this and you can anchor them using these pad eyes here, and you can move them to different parts of the pasture, and that will give you a renewable, regenerative food source for your animals. Now let's say you don't want to move the tractor every day because it's too much work for you, or it's just not something that you want to do because you don't have a ton of space or what have you. Another thing you can do, what I've also done, is I've left the tractor exactly where it's at. And every couple days, I'll take my electric lawnmower out and I'll quickly bag a couple bags of grass, which is easy to do, and I dump the grass in here. That will feed my rabbits sustainably forever. I can sustainably do that forever as long as I have grass. So if you have grass and you can mow your lawn, you have free food, you have a free food source. But let's say you have a smaller yard. Well, I'm sure your neighbors have grass. I'm sure there's lots of people that wouldn't mind having a couple bags of their grass clippings hauled off. Like I said, get creative. So another concept that I've built is pretty simple above ground hutch. Now this is great because you can feed your rabbits right here, and you can do it whether it's a commercial pellet, or you can take bags of grass and put them in here and they will eat and all the waste falls to the bottom here. Which is great because then you can take a shovel, put it in a wheelbarrow, and easily I have the most high quality fertilizer possible. I mean, this is the best stuff to put in your garden. All I have to do is just take shovelfuls of it as much as I want and put it in my garden. So this is another permaculture concept where you can grow a lot of food in a small amount of space. In fact, one of my does, can easily produce 10, 11 kits. In 8 weeks, those kits are 5 pounds apiece. So if I stagger the breeding, if I just have two females and I stagger the breeding, every month I'll have 50 pounds of high quality rabbit meat. You can't beat that. 50 pounds of high quality rabbit meat every single month. So this is also another great concept to look at. Literally, you can do a commercial pellet in this system or just use grass. Like I said, there's lots of grass here. Lots of grass that can easily be cut. So all I do is I take my electric lawnmower out, bag up a couple bags of grass, I got food. As you can see, it's divided. This is also another good concept, not just for rabbits, but for birds. You could easily put quail in here. I had quail before I had the rabbits in here, so you could easily do quail grow outs where I had my breeders in one, I had my grow outs in another, and that allowed me to pick good breeding stock to put in the breeding hutch, and I continue the process again pretty much indefinitely. So these are all great ways to grow a lot of food in a small amount of space, because you can see this doesn't take up a whole lot of space. Now some of you guys are asking, what happens if a rabbit gets out? Great question. It happens every once in a while. Look at this guy. He could easily leave. It's a big cow right there, two cows. This guy could easily leave, right? He could easily be like, you know what? I don't wanna be here no more. I'm gonna move to next county. There's nothing holding him back, but you know what? They never go anywhere. They always stay close. So if you have a means to take him out of play, if you know what I mean, it's simple to do, and guess what? He's free. He's not costing me anything because He's literally napping right now on his own food. So, again, if they get out, not the end of the world. Because, honestly, I've never had one run away. In fact, I'm raising him for free. No work required on my part. So right here we have two IBC totes, and this is gonna be the start of our aquaponics system. Now, we were gonna build a greenhouse in the wintertime, but we decided to incorporate an aquaponics system instead, and instead of doing an expensive build, we decided we're gonna test this out with just using cattle panels. So we have cattle panels that are being held up with, you see here, this is basically pallets with T-post. And so what we're gonna do is we're gonna clean out some of this wood here. We're gonna take this tarp off and we're gonna put a strong plastic weatherproof clear tarp. And we're gonna start growing food for this winter time. Now right here, as you can see, we're only starting with two IBC totes, but we can easily fit six in here, no problem, and still have space to walk in between them. So this is gonna be a great way to produce food year round. And with six IBC totes with full grow beds, we'll be able to produce more plant produce, more vegetables than we can eat here. So no matter what's going on, winter, summer, what have you, we're gonna be able to produce all the vegetables that we need here on the homestead. So again, this is not a whole lot of space here, guys, you know? So we're able to do this sustainably, but we're also able to do this in a very small area. So this idea that you can't produce food in a small area, you can't produce a lot of it, is nonsensical. Well, I'm being charged by the sheep now. Hey guys, hey, hi. Oh my goodness, they want treats. They know I'm the treat man. Look at that, looking for treats. Hey, you want some treats? Hey, I wasn't actually gonna do a video on the sheep, but since they're here, another great thing about sheep is you can also have sheep in a smaller area as well. They don't require a lot of space. Like I said, the great thing about sheep are they don't require a whole lot of space. You know, if you had a large fenced in yard, you could easily have two ewes and a ram, and you could produce up to, you know, four kits a year, you know, four lambs a year. That's not a bad gig, you know. And if you were to be able to harvest, you know, up to 50 pounds of meat per sheep, you know, that's 200 pounds of high quality meat that you're not working extremely hard for at all. Sheep are literally the easiest animal I have to raise. They take care of themselves. All I have to do is make sure they have water. And as long as there's grass growing, nothing can stop them. Another great concept to mention are fruit trees. Here's an apple tree. They don't take up a lot of space, and the space they do take up is good. I don't mind it at all. And if ever wanting to boost production, put a bunch of rabbit poop there at the base, and it'll do the rest. So this is a great way to get renewable food every single year with no work on your end. So if you have trees, or you have bushes, or you have things that aren't producing food, you can easily Right here I have a rain catchment system that I have some black silicone around it where I've basically drilled a spout into it. And you can use this to fill up any of your small waters for your animals. So all these concepts are rugged, tried and true, and they actually work. So even if there's no infrastructure out there, even if you don't have access to power, running water, these are all things you can do to grow and raise food.
There we go. You have seen the concepts there at place. We looked at the tilapia fish for aquaponics. You've clearly seen the IBC totes, how much they take up. That's great. You guys have seen the chickens and ducks. You've seen the coop system. It doesn't have to be that elaborate, but you see how much space it takes. You've seen the rabbits. You've seen the rabbits numerous times. You've seen the grow-out hutches. You've seen the grow-out cages. You know, you see how easy of application that is and how much meat that can be produced there. You know, so and quail, like just the conceptual items with the grow-out cages as well. You've seen the rain catchment systems with the water. So we see that these are no joke, tried, proven ways of growing large amounts of food in a small amount of space. There's no doubt about that. The ability to grow food in a small space is not difficult. This is something that has been done for generations and generations. Now the issue really becomes not so much that I feel that people don't know these concepts, because there's a lot of you guys that know these concepts exist, but is the sheer fact that you don't want to implement them, right? You just want to be entertained, and that's fine. But for those of you that were confused about how you can grow food in a small amount of space and do it, you know, in a way that is sustainable and do it in a way that leaves a very small carbon footprint, the whole nine yards, this is a way to do it. And it works. Obviously, for those of you that don't care either way, it's going to go through one ear and out the other. There's always going to be excuses for why you can't be prepared. And that's fine. Just, you know, if you're attesting to just stockpile and hoarding survival foods, that's fine. But for those of you that are wanting other applications, they exist. If you're curious about aquaponics, if you're curious about rabbits, if you're curious about chickens, if you're curious about ducks, please go, you know, further look into it. And I know there's going to be, for some people, an immediate hesitation just because, you know, how can I eat such a cute furry animal? You know what? Until you actually understand the importance of food and sustainability, I can't help you with that. I've never had that issue, but you're talking to somebody that grew up very poor. You're talking to somebody that had parents that went without so that I could grow. So realizing this is the reality that a lot of people live in, for me, it's of no consequence. I will do what it takes to make sure that I can feed my family, and that's that. I'm not going to depend on the evil system at B, because animal agriculture is an evil system. I'm not going to depend on handouts from an evil system. I'm not going to do it. And so once, you know, you have your morals and priorities right, producing food is super simple and super easy. So that's what I have for you guys. I hope that you guys are able to take this and use it efficiently. I want to give a shout out to Milkmaid. I want to give a shout out to Hupel's Cat. I want to give a shout out to Lone Survivor. I want to give a shout out to Mosaic Masters, or you know who you are. I want to give you guys shout outs. Thank you for having this conversation with me in the comment section of my last videos. That's why I do this. I want to learn from you guys just as much as I'm sure you guys want to learn and look at these things through a more conceptual lens. So that is our video, how to grow food without a farm or homestead or acreage. So hope that this video was helpful for you guys. If you have any questions, leave in the comment section below. To those of you that are active on my channel, you guys are great because you guys are out there answering questions before I even have a chance to look at a lot of this stuff. So I super appreciate it. Hope you guys enjoyed the video. I'm going to have some content coming out. So I look forward to that, having more of these nuanced conversations that can be a little uncomfortable, but it is what it is. Again, hope you guys like the video. As always, long live the Republic.